I think we were leaving until someone destroyed us in one of the songs.
I'm talking. I'm saying words now. You can hear the words. Okay. Is this okay? I'm not going to cause feedback. I can take my hand off the button. Okay. Yes, I could do that. We actually have to shut off all the lights on this floor to do it, but I can do it. Okay. Welcome, everybody. So I have a couple things I want to say before we get started, but I actually like to start by asking you all a question. I should check. Elliot, is everything good with the broadcast? Okay. So where did you all get to in the workshop? Anybody, just feel free to pipe up. Huh? Matches row. So where? Somewhere inside of where. Okay. Other people? Very start of where. Some people select, some people probably limit. Yeah? Okay, cool. Some people limit, some people maybe not even there yet. Some people finishing up part one. So I want to say that's okay for a lot of reasons. But I want you to know that the biggest thing probably to get out of today, and in my opinion, one of the biggest things to get out of CS Saturdays, is not just the concepts that we end up talking about, databases, database management systems. Like, that stuff is big to get out of it, but also like JavaScript practice. This is a great chance to have this problems and solve them, which we're going to have in a minute. And I want to say that going around, I saw a lot of great work. So I think you're all doing a great job, and you should feel happy about where you're at. And there's no need to feel at all upset about this, what we've done so far. OK. Excellent. Yes. Applause for everybody in general. So remember also that if you have a question, just feel free to talk to him. This is something else I want to mention. Yes. Something else I want to mention is that I've uploaded to your repos the starting point, a full solution, and also this review thing. We're going to be working out of this review one. But I wanted to let you know that in case you want to like peek at that full solution where we're getting while we go along.
Which repo did you?
I just closed everything. That was that was not my goal. It's in 1610 library inside of CS Saturday inside of O2-FQL. All right, let's make it happen. So let's look at, I didn't want that, I wanted npm test. Okay, so we've got a lot ahead of us. We've got part one and all of part two, and we'll see how we can get through that. So let's go straight to table. And somebody tell me, what's going to need to get defined on our table? the path. Okay, so it gets a folder path here, and we're going to want to store that somehow. Let's store it as underscore folder, Fodler, you know, rhymes with toddler. How about what else? What other methods and things do we need? To file name, and that what type of method is that?
Class.
Class method. So it is defined directly on the class. Other method names. To ID, also a static or class method. Let's go ahead and fill in these signatures. To file name, what does it take?
A number.
A number, or and I'll call it ID, because but it is absolutely a number. What does it return?
File name.
File name. Yeah, it's a pretty aptly named function. And this one similarly takes file name, or inversely, I should say, and returns ID. OK, so more methods. What else do we have? Get row IDs?
Yeah.
OK. What else do we have?
Read.
OK. Anything else on the table? OK, great. So nobody's saying anything, so I'm going to assume I've done this well.
I thought that read and get row IDs
were used.
Oh, yes. Thank you for the reminder. Yeah.
I thought that get row IDs and read were on the prototype rather than their instance methods rather than being class methods.
No, I think they should be class methods. Everybody agree with me? No? Instance methods? OK, fine. We'll make them instance methods. Yeah. Yeah, cool. So you're going to have to correct me. I might not tell you that I'm doing something wrong, and you'll have to just let me know. So feel free to just yell at me and be like, that's wrong. And maybe I'd, what? Feel free to yell at Mike. Pick up the mic. Yell, that's wrong. OK, get row IDs. What does this take, and what does it return? Takes nothing and returns an array of row IDs, great. An array of row IDs. So let's go ahead and get those using what method on FS? Read dirsync. Yeah, read file sync is coming in soon. But for this one, we just need to read the current folder path. And that will come back with what we might call, I'm going to start using some ES6 syntax, some light ES6 syntax, so that you all start getting used to it, file names. By the way, I want to mention that const is a lot like var. There's not a big difference. Anybody know the one difference about it? Go to Mike, please. Sorry.
You can't change the variable once you do the
query. Yeah, cannot change what the reference points to. So this is saying that file names will always point to the following array. We can still mutate that array. We just can't change file names. We can't suddenly say file names equals 5 or something. OK. So from file names, we can get row IDs by using a method we haven't written. Let's go ahead and write these methods. So this takes an ID and returns a file name, const file name. And I think we have to do something like take the ID, add JSON to the end of it, and then we also have to pad the front with some zeros. So I'm going to do that this way. I'm just going to always have 4 zeros. I'm going to add those to it, and then I'm going to slice from -9 onwards. Can you tell I've done this before? It's like weird.
Omri, so, we have a question from Amy and Remote.
Yes, Amy and Remote.
Why did we implement table to file name and table to ID as static methods and the others as instance methods? Is this a way to simulate private methods?
Fantastic question. I will answer that second part first. It's not really a way to simulate private methods. And actually, as of ES6, we have much better ways of doing private methods, which we could talk about. But I'm going to direct that back at the audience. Why would to file name and to ID be class or static methods? Remember to direct your answer to Mike.
When we create a new table, we want to be able to call get row IDs and read on that new instance.
OK, so these make a lot of sense to have get row IDs and read as instance methods. How about why didn't we have to file name and to ID as instance methods? Yeah, please.
Is it because those functions are never going to change? They're always going to operate in the same exact way, no matter if, if there's a new instance of table or not?
Perfect. Yeah, notice that I never use the this instance anywhere inside of this method. So I clearly never need a reference to an instance or anything like that. This toFileName method, it just always takes some number and always returns some string. And it works the same regardless of what instance we might care about. So we might as well implement it as a static method. That doesn't mean we have to implement it as a static method, but it's going to be clearer if we do that because we'll be saying, yeah, this doesn't rely on an instance to work. The other, but we still want it, the reason we attach it to the table as a class method is so that it's still portable. Like anywhere that table class exists, this method will travel with it. Amy, hopefully that answers your question. If not, feel free to ask a follow-up. Let's see if this works or not, this toFileName thing. While we're at it, let's go ahead and just sort of change all of these exits to its. And you know what? I'm going to make this an it dot only, just to do this one at a time for the toFileName. Command Control G. Yep. Yep. Okay, so it's totally working. Let's go down to toID. I'm going to use parseInt here on the file name, but I'm still going to have a problem. Why can't I parse the file name as an integer? Actually, maybe I can. Wait, somebody showed me this. Let's try it. Let's just try that. I'm excited.
Amy says, okay, but then we have a copy of those methods on every instance, don't we?
We do not. The toFileName and toID methods will only exist on the class. There's only one of each of them, and they just exist one time on the class. Every instance will have a reference back to its constructor, so every instance could get a reference to those functions, but we're not defining them over and over and over again. We only have to define them once. That's a good question. Let's put in the toID. Please do, yeah.
Is what you just described the difference between defining it as table dot and then the function as opposed to inside table this dot the function? That's the difference?
Oh, great, yes. I think what you're referring to is if we go to the table constructor, we could do this dot toFileName equals a function. And this is an alternative way that we could define an instance method if we wanted to. So this is instance method. And I know that because we are literally attaching it to an instance here. So this, and Amy, that gets at your question really well, actually, because if we define instance methods this way, we're going to define them over and over and over again for every instance. If we define instance methods using .prototype, we only have to define them once, and then all instances actually share those functions, which is nice. It's possible that's also what you were thinking of. Amy is very talkative, so it's funny. I feel like because normally I'm used to like saying things, and Amy will say things back. But it's just sort of silence in Elliot's voice every once in a while, channeling her. Okay, so parseInt file name. This actually works. I was surprised that this works. Anybody else surprised that this works? Nobody? Just me? Just me up here, confused? Yeah? Why are you surprised? Talk to Mike, if you are. Oh, okay. That's fair. Did I trigger that with my laugh? What did I do? Backy for a second there.
I think you're okay.
Okay. Okay, I'll keep talking. Yes. Why does that work? Apparently, parseInt, let's go into Node for a second. Apparently, parseInt is really forgiving. Yeah. It's just going to look for any digits you've got in there. Even if there's like a .json in there, it doesn't really care. It's like, oh, part of that string wasn't digits? Oh, well, I'll just throw that part out, which is kind of crazy. Yes. Remember, talk to Mike.
Parse it, it's not always like that, though. I think if you have, like, parentheses or something like that, it's going to give you not a number.
Oh, initially. I see. You mean it can fail?
Yeah.
Yes, yeah, that's definitely true. We could try, like, parseInt. Like if we were to try parse int of, I don't know, foobar, we'll get nan, not a number. Yep. Oh, and we have some, I see, yes, yes. So it's not, right, it's sort of trying its best to parse the thing as an integer, and if it can, it'll succeed, but it will fail as not a number sometimes, yeah. Okay, cool, so that's 2ID. Let's continue with get row IDs now. So we have the file names. What can I do to get those to be what we want, which are the row IDs? Non-rhetorical question. Please.
You could just use a map over the file names.
Great.
And just for each one, return the 2ID of that element.
So for each file name, return a table, capital T table dot 2ID file name. Super. So let's go ahead and run npm test on this next one now. Read from a folder. Oh, we should implement read, but let's go down to get row IDs. Yes, and that totally works as expected. There's something we can do to make this much smaller. We can actually just replace this with table.2ID. I'm going to show both here for a second. This is This is just something good to keep in mind when you're out there and programming JavaScript, really, which is if you ever find yourself defining an anonymous function that takes an argument and calls some other thing on that, calls some other function on that argument, you've actually just, all you've done is create a synonym for that function, right? We already have a function that calls 2ID on its argument. It's 2ID. So we don't actually have to produce another anonymous function that does the same thing. We can just use .2ID. Yeah.
Is it only ES6 feature or it works in ES5?
Anything. What I'm showing you so far is it will work in any JavaScript. Good question. We are going to see some cool ES6 stuff soon. Let's talk about read. Read takes what and returns what? It
takes an ID.
Great. A parsed file, yeah, let's call it a row. That sort of fits with our analogy here of tables. So I'm going to say that this row equals the result of, and here's where we can get to using read file sync. I'm going to need the folder, or the fodler, whatever we named it. I kind of want to go back and rename it fodler. And then we also need table.toFileName of the ID. So all of that together, in fact, let's capture this as another variable, especially since it's making us look at, it doesn't present well on the screen. So this will, I'll just call this thing file path. And we'll get the row by read file sync of the file path. So now that we've got that going, let's go ahead and see if our read works. It definitely does not. So there's something I'm forgetting. Something actually pretty important now that I think about it. Yeah. Yes. Somebody go talk to Mike, yeah.
JSON parse.
JSON parse, yes. Our good buddy JSON is going to parse this for us. So I'm actually going to call this thing contents, the file contents. We can pass those in, and we can return that thing, because that thing will be the row. Super. OK, and this is kind of what we have going for table. From here on out, it's going to be FQL. And a couple people started defining FQL down here, which, when I think about it, is actually a pretty natural intuition. But we've already got FQL defined elsewhere over in this other file. So we're going to start building out from that thing. So FQL takes a table, and we're going to assume that we need to keep track of it. So I'm going to do that. And give me some FQL methods. Get? I was testing you, or was I? OK, what else? OK. Huh? Limit. OK. Keep going. What else? Select. Okay. What else?
Where?
What else? There's only one left, I think, and it's inner join, and we're probably not going to do it, but it's there. So we have these various methods. Tell me about get. What does it take? What does it return?
Doesn't take anything.
So I shouldn't put anything here. Doesn't take anything. And it returns the rows. And we're going to make use of the table to do so. So we can say, use your table to read every single, let's use a let. We'll let index equals 0. And we'll say, well, the index is less than, let's get the row IDs, is this.table.getRowIDs. And then we're going to say, well, the index is less than row IDs length, index plus plus. And then I am going to this.table.read index. And that will give me a row here, right? Oh, thank you. I also had one there. Good. So I will read, and that will give me a row that I can push to rows. Rows equals that thing, rows dot push row. Okay. I left a mistake in here, and we'll see how it goes. Let's go ahead and try FQL. Constructor takes a table, can retrieve all rows, it dot only. Let's try that one. Oh, I left a mistake, but it doesn't matter. Oh, that's amazing. That's actually kind of funny. Wait, can I see something? Is it? Oh, yeah. Yep, okay, but we start with 0. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead. No, that's cheating. But if we had, like, deleted something from this, it would be a problem, right? If there was, like, 0000001003, we'd suddenly have a problem. So the issue is that this should be an ID. So let's go ahead and do row IDs index. Awesome. Count takes nothing and just returns the result of get, but only the length of it, if we want to. So it's just how many come back from it. OK, and that, along with one other line of code, where we're going to define a plan here. We're not going to fill out what it is, but we're just going to say the query has a plan. Sounds very ominous. That should fill out part one for us. Let's see. Let's see again. Yeah, so that's part one. Any questions, looking at what we've got right now, about what we've seen? So we're about to head to part two, and it'll be a wacky ride, as you all know. All right, part two. Let's make it happen. So for part two now, I'm going to go ahead and start putting in... Oh, we have a question. Yes, please.
Is there, I noticed that you put, when you did this dot folder, you put an underscore in front of the folder, you put an underscore in front of the table. Is there like a naming convention that we're using there? Or is that just?
That's a great answer too. So there is kind of a naming convention I'm using here. And it's the idea of making it sort of private. In fact, if I'm thinking of going back and changing the specs so that it's underscore plan as well. The idea here being that if you see something with an underscore in front of it, you should know that it's kind of like an internal property that the class will use, but anybody outside shouldn't be using it. So, like, for example, if somebody imports your FQL library, well, first of all, God help them, but if somebody imports your FQL library, they should not be doing things like FQL.dundertable.getRowIDs. Like, they should not be interacting with the dunder table from their code if they're using your FQL code. It's kind of a signal to other developers. Like, this is internal, don't use this property unless you think you need to. Like, we're keeping track of it because we need it. So it's sort of like a pseudo-private property. Yeah. There is a cool answer to that need in ES6 with symbols. I encourage you to look it up if you want. I don't think it's crucial enough, so I don't want to go into it here, but it is interesting. Okay, so here's our plan. Let's start part two. I'm going to start filling out some things about our plan. Okay, so let's go to our plan, plan.js. Okay, tell me how to plan. What methods should we start filling out about this plan? Set limit. Okay. What else? Huh, weird. Within limit. Okay, thank you. And these should be enough to get us to where we need to be for now. So set limit is just going to take some limit amount, and we're going to store it on the plan for later. That's the idea. And then within limit, what does that take, and what does that return? Oh, actually, we could get away without it. You're right. Like, that's actually, we could do it. Like, we could say this limit equals null. But if we don't, it'll just be undefined by default until we assign it. So, but it's probably a good idea. Yeah, you know, it's probably a good idea. So that people know that it's, like, there and, like, might be edited instead of needing to read through all of our code just to figure out what properties might be on the plan. Cool. Okay, tell me about within limit. What does it take and what does it return?
It takes an array.
Takes an array. I'm going to call this thing rows. I'm going to call it rows. Yeah. And what does it return? A boolean. True or false, like, do we have enough? Wait, no. Do we have as many as should be possible? Like, do we have too many should return false? Everything else should return true. So let's go ahead and say rows length. The rows length should be less than the limit. Like, if that's true, then we return true. There's one other case we have to deal with, which is the case that we haven't set a limit. What do we do if we haven't set a limit? Return true, as in we're always within limit, according to this. And then I'll put this inside of an else. Not that we need to, but I often prefer that. OK, let's see how that goes. Actually, no, you know what? Let's even go back to our FQL and start implementing this. So the crazy thing about our FQL stuff is that when we call .limit, it's going to take that amount, and it's going to set that onto the plan. And then that's it. Like, that's all the logic that needs to happen here, except maybe one little thing, which we should talk about. But that's it, because we aren't actually going to run the query yet. We're not going to say, actually, limit the result set yet. That's going to come in for get and how we change get. Tell me what I'm missing about limit. Tell Mike, rather. Yeah.
We need to return a query, I think.
We need to return, yeah, we need to return an FQL instance. This is the chaining pattern, and that's what you're learning to implement here, the chaining pattern. So one way we could do that is by returning this. By the way, the chaining pattern means we might want to do like FQL instance dot limit dot select dot where dot count, and do have that nice chained JavaScript. So one way we can do that is by returning this, so that the next thing that calls a method on it will be accessing that same FQL instance. Another method I saw out there, which is actually preferable in the long run to me, but which we're not really going to go into here, is returning a new FQL instance that's somehow based off of the existing one. That would take us a little bit more to do, and so I'm going to go with the smaller one that, in my opinion, is actually worse in the long run. Okay, so now we need to come back up here, and we need to say when a get happens, we need to change the logic. We need to say, you know what, let's add this condition here. And this plan within limit rows. So we are saying for index is 0, for let index is 0, while it's less than the length and within the limit, continue going through the loop. If either of those things becomes false, we exit the loop. Oh, wow. That was, I don't know. I mean, usually something breaks, right? So. But that worked. OK, so questions about limit. I want to talk about these questions now because select and where are kind of more of the same, but just harder. Harder and harder as we get through them. select. Select is going to take, you know, let's do this the non-ES6 way for a second. It's going to take arguments. So it's going to take like 0 to infinite number of column names just positionally, like column A, column B, etc. So we will use the arguments object to get what we need. And I think ultimately the only thing we're going to want to do is a lot like our limit function. We just need to say set selected or something like that and pass that thing our arguments. Then we should return our FQL instance. And let's implement this in a very weird way, which is assuming something works on the plan, which we haven't really figured, like we haven't built this yet. We're also going to come up here and use something else on the plan that doesn't exist. So what should I use on the plan up here that doesn't yet exist? Limit? Oh, well, actually, that one we already are using, this.plan.withinLimit. I mean now for the select one, but yeah. Select columns. Also, reminder to talk to Mike, but I also am forgetting myself. So select columns. So that's a method that we can expect to call on a row, this.plan.selectColumns. And it will come back with what we might call a selected row. And that's the thing that we'll push on. OK, so now it's all going to work. Exciting. Oops. Let's see. Yep, that's all of them. Great. So I'm really excited that it's definitely going to work and nothing's going to break. Oops. Nothing works. Everything broke. Opposite. Yeah. Oh, Mike. Yeah, sorry. I'm sorry.
Can you go back to the other page? I think you put them on. I think they were supposed to be on FQL. The to be selected.
To be selected? Is that what you said?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, like the on. Yeah. So you're absolutely. We haven't filled stuff out about the plan yet. I think that's maybe what you're getting at.
Yeah.
Like we have. We're pretending to use methods on the plan, but they never existed. So everything is very upset at us. Rightly so. So we can go to the plan now and start implementing some additional methods that we kind of need, like prototype set selected, which is going to take an array of column names and set those to be a selected property, or whatever we want to call it, really. So I'm going to do that same pattern, because I like that idea, of setting it to be null by default. And then we want one other thing, which is select columns. Okay. This one is going to take a row, and it's going to return, again, what we might call a sort of selected row. So let's start that off as an empty object by default, and eventually we're going to return it. What do we do in the meantime to get it to be what we want? I'll repeat that. Yeah, we want to be checking every key that we put on selected. That's what you're saying? Great. And
Okay,
got it. Check if it's in the selected property of plan. So what you're suggesting is start with the row, go down all its keys, find the ones that are in selected. I'm going to do this kind of reversed. I'm going to say go through the selected and just take those keys out of the object. So this.selected. Dot, what's the thing I'm thinking of here? The word map? For each. There we go. For each column in selected, take it off of the row and assign it to the selected row. So we're adding keys selectively based off of our select. And I believe that's the basic gist, though there are a couple things we haven't dealt with, some very important edge cases. Help me out, somebody. Help Mike out, rather. Yeah.
If we by default set it to an empty array instead of null, then we'll deal with the never initiating the selected, I believe.
Oh, I see. Right. We want a situation where like selected hasn't happened. So I'm actually going to put that up at the top here. I'll say if this.selected is null, let's return the row as is. Like, don't do any selections on it. There's another thing, which is that the selected might come in as star. So let's deal with that situation too. In fact, let's deal with it in the FQL, because there's so little logic here going on, we might as well. Let's go ahead and say if arguments 0 is star, sorry, is not star, then set selected, otherwise don't do anything, just return this. That way we'll just go to that default case by default of selecting everything. Or we could actually pass in, we could set it to null actively. It depends how we want to do it. But this is the basic idea. Let's see where this gets us. We have a for each is not a function. So that can happen, that can happen if your arguments object is not an array. Yeah? Because if you notice what we're doing, we're passing arguments to set selected, which is passing it to the plan here, which is saving it on this underscore selected. So that's the same arguments object. Then down here, we're trying to call for each on it. Thoughts? What can I do? Yeah, please.
It's the arguments array. It's not like real array. So we kind of need to transform it into the real array before we pass it.
All right, so let's do slice call. So this is one way we can do that. We can take the array prototype method slice function and call it with arguments as its context, and hopefully that'll give us an array. Cool. This is the right idea. So we're getting the right thing. I'm going to show you now some useful ES6 stuff that you will see out there. This is the REST operator. So another thing we can do now in ES6 is the dot, dot, dot inside of our parameter declaration to say, like, I'm capturing the arguments, but I'm calling it this thing, columns. And it'll give us an array, not this weird arguments object thing. And then we won't need to do slice.call. I can comment that one out, and it should work exactly the same way, except we didn't need to do that. Cool. It's a cool thing to know about. Not at all necessary. I'll leave it there as a comment. Yes?
Is there an actual reason for the arguments object to exist? And does it still exist? Because I don't see why you wouldn't do this.
Is there, like, so your question is, why do we have the arguments object anymore? My answer will probably be backwards compatibility. Like, we used to not have this in ES5. And at that point, arguments was kind of necessary for situations like we have here. So now that we've got the dot, 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 the REST operator, it's nice that we can use it, but we should keep in mind that like some people's browsers might not be running ES6. They might be running ES5. So it's still useful to know about and useful to have around. But yeah, correct. If you want to stop using it entirely for the rest of your life, you probably could. And you could, like, if you're worried about old browsers, you could use a transpiler, which will convert your ES6 code into ES5 code. And it will do this conversion for you of the dot, dot, dot into arguments, basically. All right. Super. Now it's time for where, which is a personal favorite of mine. I really love this workshop. I kind of want to go back to table for a sec, because there was something I wanted to mention here. It always just blows my mind that, like, just this by itself, what we've written here, it's not that much code. There's not a lot going on. But we're seeing the heart of what a database management system is. It's something that can, like, read from disk and write, and we haven't gotten to writing yet, but read and write to disk and convert that into some format that somebody else can use it. So that's pretty cool, and it doesn't take a lot to make it happen. Similar to what we're seeing in FQL right now is the heart of what a query engine needs to do. And we're abstracting some of that onto the plan, but I just like it a lot. I don't know how to say it, but I'm just having a lot of fun. Okay, let's go on to where. So where takes what we might call like criteria, and it's going to do a similar kind of pattern where we take the plan, and let's have a set criteria method, and we will return the this. So now we should go to our plan and have plan prototype set criteria be a function that takes criteria, and that'll return, what am I doing? That will do this, criteria equals criteria. And let's default that thing to be null. All right, what else do we want on our plan? What kind of abstract method are we gonna end up using inside of our get? Matches row. Plan prototype matches row. Tell me what this takes and what it returns.
Takes a row.
Yeah, cool. What does it return? A Boolean. And let's call that thing is a match. It returns whether or not a given row matches based on the criteria that that plan is storing. So let's go ahead and build out the logic for that. Let's look at the criteria just to make it clear what we're talking about here. I think Shrek. Yeah. Oh, wow, that was an amazing find. All right, so where name is Shrek. This is what our criteria will look like. It'll be an object where the key is some column name, and the value is some possible value. Similarly, which we'll get to soon, we could have multiple criteria, like where rank is 8.5 and year is 1999. So we should deal with that situation. And we'll get to soon the possibility that the query contains what's known as a predicate function, which matches not on equality, but based on some thing that the predicate function defines. We'll get to that soon. OK, so the plan is match. So we want to go down everything in the criteria, every single key inside of it. And for each, yeah. Well, OK. I'm undecided. You know what? Let's do it this way. Let's do a for var in for a sec. So for, and I'll do a let, not that it matters too much here. OK, for let column in the criteria, we will have that column to find the row's value. And we will also be able to get the condition from the criteria. OK. So our question is going to be, like, do they match or not? If they match, what do we do? It's kind of a
pass.
Great. So we could use continue. Great, I heard that out there. So we could use continue to go to the next cycle of the loop and try the next criteria in our list, criterion in our list. What about if they don't? So like we get to a row, and its year is 3050, which is cool, because it's a movie in the future. And it doesn't match 1999. So return false. Great. So regardless of what criterion we're on, if it doesn't match, we can immediately return false. We can say, no, this row does not match, because it has to match every single criterion. So I just love saying that word. So at the end, we can say return true, which will be our way of saying, if you've gone through all of them and have not yet returned false, return true. They all must have matched. So there's one thing I'm missing in edge case. It's kind of similar to others we've seen. Somebody tell me about that. Somebody tell Mike about that, rather. Mike is a great listener.
If the criteria is null, then you should return true right away.
Yeah, excellent. So if we have never set the criteria, oops, then we should just return true, as in it's a match because we don't have any criteria to match on. And otherwise, we'll go down this loop. So let's see how that does us. Let's go through. Oh, man, this is a lot. Exit, 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 given criteria, blah, 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 works with multiple fields. We haven't done the function stuff yet. Oh, well. OK, cool. So some beautiful red marks for us. But some of those, at least, are expected, because I know we haven't done part of it. The question is, are we passing any of them? Oh, wait, I haven't done anything, have I? No, I've built all this stuff, but I haven't actually changed anything important. OK, Like, yeah, so we're not doing anything inside of FQL to use matches row. Where should I do that? Dot where should I do that? Get. Okay. So inside here, I'm actually going to put all of this whole thing inside of happy little if block that says only do this if plan matches row, row. All right, we can try one more time and see which ones fail this time. A lot of scrolling. OK, so we're getting further. We're now actually, now our only problem are these predicate functions that I mentioned earlier. But fundamentally, we're on the right track. So let's go make those work. If we go back to the plan, we just have another possible situation. So our possible situation is, by the way, we can, before we go on, I want to simplify this. Let's just go ahead and say if val is not, return false. And then we don't even need our continue statement. OK. Let's go ahead and add something else, which is if our condition is actually a function, we have to do something different. And else if it's not, ooh, actually, could we just do else if here? I think we could. Yeah, else if val is con, return false. Great. So, but if it's a function, what do we do? Let me go look at those part of the specs which talk about predicates. Here's our very first one. We have a column called name, and the value, the criterion of that column, is a function that will take name value for a given row, and it will return whether or not it has no E's. Right. This is matching movies without the letter E in their title. So let me split screen this for a second. View layout two rows. Just pull this one, that was the wrong place. Let's pull this one down here. Let's go back to plan for a second. So again, this is the pattern we're trying to get, and this is what we've got so far. What do I do inside line 48?
Invoke the function con?
Yeah, so we'll invoke con. Excellent. And what do we pass to it? Val, correct. We pass to it any given value for the row we happen to be on for the specific column we're testing on. And if this comes back false, E, what do we do? Return false. And if it comes back truthy, what do? Nothing at all. OK, let's delete this else. Cool. We just continue to the next condition, right? Excellent. So there we go. Let's see how that works for us. Oh my goodness. Where am I? Let's just try it. Super. So this is passing all the ones that I want to talk about in this part of the workshop. There's join, but that's actually bonus stuff, and it is kind of especially weird, if you can believe it. You're like, isn't this all pretty weird? This is especially weird. Okay. All right, layout, back to single layout. There's another implementation of matches row I'd like to show you that I would consider especially functional, because it makes less use of this iterative loop and instead uses an array method. So we can return this criteria. In fact, let's capture it as a value. Is match equals, and we will return it. OK, so the idea here is we're going to go down the criteria, and we're going to say dot every. And dot every works the following way. Just like other array methods, we have access to every, we have access to each array element. And what we need to do is we need to return true or false inside of dot every. If we return true, it goes to the next one, the next element in the array, and continues trying things. If we return false, dot every actually knows to short circuit, to stop right now, and return true back out to whatever is capturing it. Here is match. So for us, now we have a situation where we can take the inside of this loop and have it a little bit, like this is relying on some, I think, some difficult logic to parse. Like we're basically saying, if it's a function and it's not true, return false, which is a little strange. And then if it is true, we're just continuing, but there's nothing to indicate that very effectively. And here we're saying, okay, and otherwise check if they're equal, and if they're not equal, return false. And then we kind of have our return true at the bottom. So I think the logic here is a little bit more awkward and can be expressed more nicely here, because up here we can just return false or return true if we want. And if we return true, we'll tell it to keep going forward. So we can now express, we want these same values. Ooh, this is good. I'm glad I did this. And then we're going to do if type of cond is function inside of our callback, we can just return the Boolean that cond comes back with. Either it's true or it's false. If it's true, we continue to the next one. If it's false, we don't. And then we can say otherwise return whether or not they're equal. And then that's actually all we have to say. So I don't know if it's actually, it might be slightly shorter. I don't know if that really matters to me. But I like that we can express our logic in a more natural way of just returning a Boolean value to this callback. So this is using every method. Well, dot, the dot every method. Not literally every method. Okay. There are strange things that disturb me sometimes, and this is one of them. Okay. I used it. I commented it out, and then it worked. Hey, cool. Quite a magic trick there. So let's try it again. This is going to fail, and I'm excited about it failing. This.criteria.every is not a function. That's not actually what I was expecting to see as the failure. That's kind of cool. I was kind of expecting something else, but let's go back down here for a second. Huh. Okay. Wait a second. Did I do something wrong here? This under criteria. Oh, yeah, I totally did something wrong here. I need to do object.keys. Cool. We'll see a new bug in a second. It's very exciting. And we all can't wait for this bug. Okay. Good. There we go. Can't read under criteria of undefined. Raise your hand if this something like this sounds familiar. Like if you came across a bug like this during a workshop or before in your life. Okay. Is like, are there any alarm bells going off in your head just when you see it? Tell me those alarm bells. Yeah. What are these? What's your spider sense saying?
Well, in our case, it had to do with what this was in the context.
Yeah, that's good. Let's even go to line 66 for a second. We're going to see cond equals this dunder criteria column. And notice that it's saying cannot read property dunder criteria of undefined. So it's trying to do dunder criteria of this. So that means this is undefined. And why is this undefined? Yes.
Because you're inside a new function scope, so this got redefined in .every?
Yes, because we're inside of a different function scope here. Where are we? Here, this function. The function that I'm naming right now. That I'm naming right now. This one. R-I-G-H-T. So that thing is a totally different function with a totally different execution context than matches row. And that means that this is not necessarily the same in exactly the same way that its argument row is not the same as this argument column. That's kind of how this works. It's almost like an argument that gets passed into a function when it gets invoked. And in our case, the way that the function that I'm naming right now is being invoked is not preserving the context that we want to preserve. So let's solve this in like five different ways in a minute. So one way. Let's do closure. Const self equals this. Self, oops, really going to make this minute kind of hard. Self dot criteria columns. So that's one way we can solve it. can close over the context where we have it outside, and we can use it where we need it. Yes?
Will this work in strict mode?
This will should even work in strict mode, what we're seeing here. Let's try it out. Yes. And I want to point out, we're in strict mode. This is just closure here. That's all we're really doing. That's the effectiveness of it. Somebody give me another method we can use, another way we can do this.
Bind.
OK, so we can take the function that we've got, and I'm going to wrap it in a bunch of parens so that I can call .bind on it. And I will pass .bind the outer context. So here we're saying take a function, give it the this of what we're currently inside of, which is the outer function, and make that its sort of baked-in context. So when you invoke it, it always has that context. And then we can come up here and do this criteria. OK, because this is map, we can also do something else, which is pass a second argument to map. Ooh, tricky. For the map method, it actually, I don't know if this is going to work for .every. I said it was .map. Let's find out. But for a lot of these array methods, this is a very common issue. So what they allow you to do is pass an optional second argument to them, which will be the context with which to run the iterator on. Well, what we had before was closure with const self equals this. What we're doing here is really just passing an optional parameter to the argument. And it's going to be doing .bind or .call or something for us. OK.
Omri, I have a question from Amy again.
Yes, Amy, again.
What do array-like objects exist rather than having them as arrays?
Could you say it again?
Ask for spelling.
Give me one second. OK. Oh, I see. Like the arguments object. Like, why do we have it in the first place? I don't know, actually. Like, I'm not sure what possessed somebody to decide, oh, we should have an array-like object that's going to work like an array, except for ways that people care about. So I have no idea what possessed somebody to do that. But it was probably a decision that was made for, like, good reasons at the time that is now pretty much no longer true. But since it was made and then supported in JavaScript, we now need to continue to know about it. That's the beauty of JavaScript. OK, so we're going to come back up here. I'm going to show you another way, which is using ES6 arrow functions. So in ES6 arrow function, you can delete the function part of it and add this little arrow in between the parens and the brackets, and that's your arrow function. The neat thing about arrow functions is that they do not define their own context. They inherit their context from wherever they are defined. So this arrow function is defined inside of the function I'm now highlighting, the matches row function. So that means it will just copy that context. It won't get its own. So this we're seeing will be the same everywhere inside of the matches row function. Yes?
Although it would definitely be like a hacky way, would it work if you did, not the arrow function, if you did this dot constructor? Would that reference the?
Here? Constructor?
Yeah.
That would give us the same kind of problem, actually, because we would get cannot read property constructor of undefined. Our original problem was that this was undefined, not that it just was the wrong thing, but it was just completely undefined. Oh, I see. Yeah, it doesn't help us out. But it's a good thought. I like it. All right, so let's leave the arrow function in there as one possibility. And let's confirm everything is actually still working. It is. OK. So we are going to stop here. This review solution should look a lot like the full solution. And I'm actually going to, like, if you didn't fully finish, which I think is all of you, feel encouraged to use this review solution on parts 3 and 4. I would not recommend using the full solution. So I'll just go back and show you what I mean there. Open dot dot slash. There's full solution, review, and starting point. I would encourage you to use that thing there, that review thing that we were just working on together. One, you saw me code all of it out. And in fact, you may have helped for parts of it, so you probably have a better understanding of it. But two, full solution includes the inner join stuff, which changes things in weird ways and is not necessary at all for parts 3 and 4. So you can definitely use either if you'd like, or your own if you also want to do that. That's fine. But if you're going to use ours, I encourage you to use review. OK, that said, are there any questions? Are there any remaining questions about any of this stuff we just talked about? Yes?
What time is the review
going to be? I'll just repeat it. Yeah. The question was, what time is the review going to be? And the review is going to be at 6 o'clock. I believe our schedule says 10:30 to 6:30 today. So the review for parts 3 and 4 is going to be from 6 to 6:30. Before we start that, we're going to have like a 10-minute lecture on indexing, which is coming up like right after this. But yeah, so that's going to be 6 to 6:30 is the review for parts 3 and 4. I expect to only get through part 3 in that 30 minutes. And at that point, we will stop. And if anybody wants to stay and watch me review part 4, they can. And if you don't, you can leave. I mean, you can always kind of leave. Like, I'm not going to stop you, but you can really leave if you want. OK, everybody. So I'm going to put up a timer here for, let me get the timer out first so you don't go anywhere yet. Timer for 5 minutes. And I'd like you all to come back here in 5 minutes so that we can start the lecture on indexing that will help you for parts 3 and 4. Okay. Elliot, how are you doing? You ready to go? Maybe we're still going. I don't know. Give me 1 second. All right. It's been 1 second. Do you need more? All right, thank you. So, welcome back, everybody, to lecture part 2 of FQL, indexing. Raise your hand if you have heard of indexing at all in databases. Cool, good. Raise your hand if that was in like the last week, like here. Okay, cool, yeah, I thought so. So we're gonna talk about it here, and you're gonna implement it in our FQL, which is just the coolest thing. So, let's talk a little bit more about indexing, and I'm going to use an example. By the way, this table here that I'm showing you, this numbers table, is in the FQL repo. It is right there. Like, alongside film database, there's table for visualization only dot numbers. You can tell I named it because it's really long. Okay. So there's this thing, which you can check out if you want to, just to see what's going on. And I also have an example of some indexing over there. So let's talk about being nice to our computers, essentially. Like when we, let's go to actors even. Like let's say I'm going to go through and find all actors with the first name. What's a pretty uncommon first name here that I can pronounce also? How about, can anybody pronounce that one? Help me out here. Ryuchiro? That makes sense. It looks like that. Okay. Ryu. What? It's pronounced Omri. Thank you, Tessa. Would you please say that into mic? Okay, Ryuchiro. So let's say we're going through our actors table and we say select star from actors where first name is Ryuchiro. This is first name, right? Yes. Okay. Excellent. So here's what our table is going to do. It's going to be like, okay, cool. Let me start here. Is that person's first name Ryuchiro? No. Is this person's first name Ryuchiro? No. Is this person's first name Ryuchiro? No. Is this person's first name Ryuchiro? Et cetera. Should I keep going? Does anyone want me to keep going? Okay. Is this person's name Ryuchiro? No. Is this person's name Ryuchiro? No. All right. Eventually, we would get to Ryuchiro. Here we go. Yes. And we add it to a list. Is this person's name Ryuchiro? No. Is this person's name Ryuchiro? Okay, so we're not even done. Even once we found that probably one or two people in there, we're not even done yet. And we have, a while to go. And this is not even a huge table by computer standards. This is a couple thousand entries. We could easily have tables out there with millions of entries to look through. So if you were the computer, you would probably not want to do it that way. You would prefer to do something else, especially if you're going to be doing this multiple times. So if you just have to do it once, then okay, you can do it once and that was kind of bad. But if you're going to have to be doing this like hundreds and hundreds of times per second, oops, ow. Okay, so let's talk about what we can do. Somebody tell me about indexing, what you recall. Tell Mike, rather, sorry.
We could basically set up like a version of this list that like hypothetically is alphabetized by first name. So when you're looking for a name, it'd be less of a pain.
Awesome. Fantastic. So we could set up another copy of the database, in a way, that is sorted by first name. And this is an index that would be using a sorting algorithm to be effective. Because what we could do there is if somebody needs to find Ryuchiro, we could just jump, say, halfway through the list, and we would see maybe, maybe we would see Chris. And we'd be like, okay, that's not far enough. And we would jump half of the way from there to the rest of the bottom, and maybe we would overjump. But either way, we would get there pretty quickly by jumping through half of the list at a time, half of the remaining list at a time. So that would be pretty cool, and it would also work really well if we were looking for a range. Like if we wanted to ask for all of the people whose last name started with R, that would be much more performant than what we have with this table scan approach of just looking through all of them. So, okay, so that's great. That's a sorted index. There's also what we might call a hashed index or a hashing index. What might we do instead? It doesn't involve sorting, but it does involve another copy of the database, so to speak. Yes, please.
Could you create a table of first names that are in your database and then scan through those for all the matches? And then in this just have that be instead of a name, be a reference to that table?
Yeah, perfect, right? So we can make another copy of the table. This is sort of like an index at the back of a book that says, like, Ryuchiro, and it says all of the places in the database, or if this is a book, all of the pages in the book where that name appears. So let's go look at movies. This is our movies table, and here is our movies table, our index table for movies, indexed specifically by year. So what we've done is we've gone down one time to create this index table, and we've gone through all of these, and we've said, okay, Aliens is 1986, let's remember its ID, which is 0. Let's go put that over here. Animal House is 1978, let's remember that ID. There are some situations we're into where we'll have the same thing, right? So we might have, I'm not seeing any yet, but we could have duplicates. Two 2000s, Memento and Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? So we need to make sure that in that case we're storing multiple IDs. So that's what it looks like over here in our index table. In our index table, the columns are actually year values because we've indexed by year. And the values are like, or the value, I should say, is an array of data there. So this is kind of what our index table looks like. And that means that when we want to, we can go, now when we go to search for the year 2000 or something, we can quickly get to this thing and see, oh, here are the four things in the table we need. And then we can come back to the main table and look up those four IDs in four operations. And it took us kind of five operations, one to find all of the indexes, four more to look everything up, instead of 36 to go through everything in the table. Okay, so that's kind of our indexing idea. So somebody, give me a description of, again, how we create it. To create a hashed index table. And it's going to be for a given column. What do we do? Yeah, please.
You would just have to scan whatever row you want to index and just look for unique values.
Got it. Go through all the rows looking for the value at that column name. Add that value as a column in your index table. Add that row's index as a value, add that row's index slash ID as a value to the index table entry you are creating. Okay, cool. And then later when we want to, we can use that index table to speed up our WHERE query. So what we'll do is go straight, look up stored indexed ID list for that index table for a given value. Year index table value 2000. Okay, then go to the main table and, loop through those IDs, and gather the rows from the main table. Corresponding rows from the main table. Excellent. There's one other thing we should keep in mind, because our WHERE query could include indexed fields and non-indexed fields. Like, we could say, find it where the year is 2000, and the rank is greater than 7, but we haven't indexed by rank. So what should we do in that case? Yes?
We should look through the indexed ones first, because it's fastest, and then look through the remaining, like, the rows that are returned to see if they match the other criteria.
Great. So if there are remaining criteria, check them as normal on the subset of rows you already have. Awesome. So that's essentially indexing in a nutshell, hashed index that we're going to use for FQL. And now I'm even going to show you the spec just so we can talk about this in even more context. If we look at the spec for part three, this is what it's wanting the index table to look like. This thing here. And this is specifically the index table for year. Every index table is particular to a column that we've got. So if we've indexed by year, that index table, the keys in it are various year values that we've got. And the values that we have are an array of all of the IDs for those different movies. So again, what we can do with this index table, if we know that we're looking for where year is 2000, we can immediately jump to that in our hash table to get 2000. Then we get this array of four things. Then we can go through and loop through looking up all of those things. And then we can continue for any other criteria we've got, like rank is greater than 7 or whatever, for those four that we just retrieved. So that's indexing in a nutshell. And it is just remarkably faster. So tell me about this speed up. Normal table scan. O of what? N. Which normally is not that bad, but what's, but really, what are we comparing it to? What's our index table scan? Or indexed query or something? Yeah, that's a good one. So it depends, actually. I will say that. It can be log of n. Yes, worst case is O of n if all of the entries are in there. It's O of log n if we've got a sorted index. But how about if we've got a hashed index? And I agree with you that the worst case is that. And we actually should talk about the index query lookup. Let's say we're not going with the worst possible situation, even if we're describing the big O. I'll talk about why that distinction kind of matters in a sec, but constant time. Yeah, excellent. This is O of 1. This is O of who cares? It was so fast we don't even need to describe it kind of thing. So that's amazing. That really doesn't get any better than that. And I want to say that O of log n is actually also incredible speed up to O of n. I encourage you to look at like a chart, but O of log n basically just looks like a flat line when you look at it on a graph. So even sorted index are really effective. And remember, they're especially effective for when we need to get a range of values for a hashed index. All right. So there are some situations where indexing can be bad. Somebody tell me about that. Somebody tell me some field we probably wouldn't want to index by in the actors table.
Gender. Yeah.
Gender. OK. Why doesn't that help us so much? Yeah.
It seems kind of like binary search trees, where if you have one really long tree that has a lot of entries in it, it ends up being just like an array.
Yeah, that's a good way of thinking about it. It's a degenerate index in a way. Like it's what we're going to do is end up indexing like basically we're going to have two things, M and F, and they're going to each of them point to about half the table, so it doesn't really get us anything. And in fact, it hurts us a little bit. Because indexing has a cost to it. What's the cost of indexing?
Memory.
Memory. Excellent. So space. What's another cost?
Insertion time.
Insertion time. Good. And similarly, update. Time. Because every time now we go to, if we have an existing index table for movie, and we go to add a movie in, we need to not only add it to our main table, we need to add it to our index table. And if we have like six different index tables, we need to add it to all of them. So every time we insert, every time we update, we now have some additional costs with that. Okay. So indexing is not always the way to go. I think that just about covers everything I want to talk about with indexing. Are there any questions that you all have that for some reason you have not asked? And me asking that would make you ask them.
Okay. how do you know whether it's appropriate to create an index or not? Like, what's the break point?
Oh, fantastic question. So this, how do you decide on this trade-off, whether it's the way to go or not? That's a fantastic question. I would say it's very like case by case. There are some obvious wins. Like, if you've got a unique field, like name is a great thing to index on because it's going to speed up a lot. You're going to have a lot of different names going out there, so you're not going to have these huge arrays in your index table. It's going to be very performant. And it's probably going to be something you're querying on a lot, that name. If it's a field that you don't really query by, then why bother indexing, right? Even if you could, like even if we know we're never going to query on name, it's just not worth it to add the index table in. The other thing is, what concerns do you have? Like, if you are concerned about space, like let's say you're running this thing on a tessel, and you're like, maybe I shouldn't index anything, because like I only have a little bit of space anyways. So if you're really trying to conserve your space, index tables are probably not the way to go. And I would say the other, and actually a similar consideration there is, if you're really, really concerned about your write speed or your update speed for a given field, you want to make sure that you don't like slow that down at all, then you don't want to index by that field, because suddenly you're going to be slowing it down. But as far as that other thing, like let's say all of those things aren't true. You're not too concerned about write slowdowns, and the only question remaining is like, should I index gender? I'm going to be searching by it often. I don't care about the overhead of space. I don't care about slowing down my write speed. And at that point, I think the conventional wisdom is even if it's somewhere between like a quarter and a half or something of the table, that's not worth it. Like the overhead from just keeping those indexes is just not really going to be worth it. You need something much more unique than that. I'm trying to find the right word, much more distinct than that, than gender, which is so uniform for our table. Now, if we had a more open-ended definition of gender here, that might actually be more effective, because maybe we'd have like 1,000 entries, but, you know.
Omri, I have a question from Sean in remote.
Yeah.
Why not just keep index hashes in RAM and not even bother persisting the disk?
Why not keep them in RAM? Excellent question. I'm going to ask it right back to you all. This is what I do with questions. I get you to answer them. So why not? Why wouldn't we keep our indexes in RAM? Why would we bother saving them actually to disk?
Because you would lose them and have to remake them like every time you turned your computer off?
Yep. We have that additional cost of every time we start our server up again, we would need to recreate those indexes. Which, remember, is kind of a costly thing to do. We have to do a full table scan to create them that one time. So we want to make that as infrequent as possible. If for some reason you're certain that you're never going to turn off that machine, it's always just going to be running, then I suppose you could keep them in memory. Like, there's nothing really stopping you. I can't think of any other reason that it matters. And you will have the additional benefit of it being kind of faster, because it'll be accessing in memory instead of from disk. On the other hand, I will say that in general, databases are pretty good at trying to cache the requests you make so that they'll keep stuff in memory. It depends on the database, but like they'll try to keep stuff in memory if they can in case you ask for it again soon. So they'll try and do that caching for you, so you usually don't have to worry about it. It's a good question. Yes, please.
Is it possible also like to share it between memory of a couple machines? So for example, if one is down, then you use the other one and...
Oh, like you have it in memory. And if this one, you know you're going to shut this one off, you want to like transfer it over to that one for a bit so that this can hold on to it. Yeah, I don't see why not. But it's just as expensive an operation as remaking it, because you now just have to send it. Right? You have to go through entry by entry and send your index table from here to something else and have it hold on to it. I don't think you've really saved yourself anything by doing that, except allowing yourself to turn it off and not losing it completely, maybe. I like these thoughts. I like this mad science going on. Okay. All right, let's stop here. Parts 3 and 4 are already open in the workshop. Have at them. Definitely focus on part 3, which is about indexing. Part 4 is about like writing to tables and relates to indexing, but part 3 is important, and that's the main thing we're going to be covering at 6 o'clock in an hour and a half, which I'm sure is plenty of time to do this. Good luck.
Is there like a benefit between, like I know when we did hash tables in like the data structures lecture,